And can I start by welcoming you to the first meeting that we've started with our new Oversight Committee for this year. New members, it's great to have you on board for those of you who've been here before. You know what you're for. So I'm going to start with apologies for absence. I've got Bernie Moon, who has been identified for by Chris Meaden. Anybody else? No? Well, that's something that's good. Any declaration of interest? Can I ask your friend if you did that or no?
I don't know if it's a declaration of interest, Chair. You've got the adoption of model council members planning care. As a deputy on planning, you don't have to declare an interest.
No, because the matter will go to council.
Okay, so can I ask you, item three on the agenda is the minutes of the meeting on 27th of February. For those of you who were here, are you happy that these are not the members of the meeting?
Yeah.
Okay?
Yeah.
Item 4 is adoption of model council members planning code on page 9.
Members, this report is submitted to the committee to recommend the council adopts the model council members planning code, which has been produced by lawyers in local government. A copy of the code is attached as an appendix to the report. The members' planning code was originally prepared by lawyers in local government in response to a series of successful legal challenges to planning decisions. As you'll be aware, the council must act in accordance with the necessary legislative requirements when dealing with planning matters. And the purpose of the model code is to ensure that best practice is followed and then therefore we comply with the legislation. This version of the code, which was updated in 2013, takes into account the Nolan principles. It also takes into account Section 25 of the Localism Act of 2011, which introduced provisions for dealing with allegations of bias or predetermination or matters that would otherwise raise an issue about the validity of a decision. And it also takes into account the guidance issued by the Department for Communities and Local Government in 2013. Which was entitled Openness and Transparency on Personal Issues and Interests. So basically adopting the model code will minimise the risk within the planning process of suggestions being made that a decision has been biased or partial or not well-founded in any way. So basically this recommendation is that subject to your views and then subject to the views of the planning committee to which we would refer this report as well, that the matter then be referred on to full council for approval of an amendment of the constitution to include. Obviously if the planning committee do raise any issues, the matter will go back for further discussion if required.
Okay, anybody
want to
ask any questions?
Yeah, just to clarify, Chair, I think I'm in a similar position to Chris. I'm a deputy on planning. So if somebody rang me up tomorrow and said they were concerned about planning applications, I'm supposed to say to them straight away, I'm sorry, I can't really discuss it with you because I might prejudice my position. And you have to pass them on to another councillor then. Or can you have some preliminary discussions without giving a view? Just to be clear.
You can listen to what people have to say and have discussions, but you need to make it clear that you are a member of the committee and obviously you don't want to be put in a difficult position.
You couldn't say, yeah, I agree with it or
wouldn't be particularly wise doing that.
Well, you could, but then you wouldn't have the time.
Yeah, that's it.
Well, that's not different from how it works now, actually, is it? But I'm assuming that now we're going to refer to the planning committee for them to give their views. Yeah, I presume there'll be including deputies in that. Will they? How will they do that? You know,
I don't know what particular plans the planning committee have got. Okay, you do need to bring it to the attention. Okay,
it's up to them. And once it's been planned and they've given their views, if they're happy with it, then the political council can become part of the constitution. So that's a recommendation that we forward this. Yes,
right. Well, does this device switch itself on now?
No, it doesn't. It's not like
press it to excellent. Thank you. Towards the end of the document, there's a note about training for planning members. I really dropped into the training because I had to go to school governors or something afterwards. It does say quite strongly, don't participate in decision making during the planning matters if you've not attended management training. Looking at the list of members of planning and deputies last night, because I was emailed about a matter, it's seem to occupy about 30 odd members of the council at the size of this. So I'm wondering whether whether the pressures on planning staff at the moment, and I think she and they might have attended overnight for her doing the training. There might be a need to offer additional or repeat training courses so we don't run out of people in order to service them.
Is there a recommendation, is there a mechanism for us, as we're referring this to planning in the chair, planning in the first instance, to ask if they can refresh the training?
Yes, perhaps if I can help, some initial training session did take place. Mr. McCourt did do some training for planning committee members, and further planning training is being arranged. So there was, that was, we felt that the training that was carried out was sufficient for members to sit on the committee, and new members to sit on the committee and understand the basics. As I say, further detailed planning training will be available, and I'm sure Mr. McCourt will be happy to repeat his session if any members have.
From our perspective, we simply refer it to the planning committee. They'll make their arrangements as they need to make sure they've captured the views, and then we'll go with it.
Just a question, so much devotion this, but how do we know, as a council, when we're in the planning committee, if everyone's sitting on that committee, get some training? Because if suddenly, you know, the deputy is required, and I can handle it, I'll do it, then deputy found, I've not attended a training session. When I get to committee, will I be disbarred and deputising? And who will know?
Well, clearly a record was kept of the members who attended the training, and if any members or deputies were not on the list as attending, then clearly we will need to make arrangements to ensure that they are given appropriate training.
Again, just on an exactly the same point. But it's not a status requirement, we're just putting it as an advisory requirement that you should have sat in on the train. For example, I sat in on the train, and sorry, didn't attend the train, and last time I was a councillor back in 2014, but I sat in on numerous meetings that didn't disable me from being able to question the officers in a reasonable manner, and it shouldn't actually exclude me from voting in the same manner.
The thing is like this is we're adopting this because what's been tell me if I'm wrong, what's been in existence to this point hasn't necessarily been a model of good practice. The reason for this is to adopt a model of good practice. So what might have been okay a couple of years ago, going forward, if the requirement is that people who are sitting on planning and making decisions about planning need to have proper planning training, then that will have to be done, and that's how the constitution will have to work. But our role in this tonight is to say we are content that this is a satisfactory model, and we're sending it to planning for them to have a look at. If they're okay and they've got views about any aspect of it, after that, I don't know. We have to also whether we go to council straight away to the constitution. So can I ask for that to agree on that?
Please.
And the next item five, is the establishment of the working group. Now, as the year goes on, this working group is probably going to be the bit that does all the work for the committee and then feeds back into the committee, because there's a big piece of work which I don't think it's going to talk about. And the next item, looking at the constitution and whether there's work that needs to be done to make sure that we've got a robust constitution. So this working group, I think that we had a meeting the other day of the working group and we looked at the options of the membership, and I think we agreed that we'd go for three Labour group, two members, the third group and one Liberal Democrat. Are we happy in the first instance that that was going to be made up? And then independents as well, who unfortunately don't have a vote, but I think we're asking for one independent person to be part of it. Upstairs, we were talking in casual conversation about how often you're likely to meet. I would see it as being probably about every fortnight, possibly every 3 weeks, and probably no longer than about 2 hours maximum, 2 hours maximum. So that's the sort of commitment we're looking for, but the daytime meetings. So, are we happy to, first of all, adopt the option of 3-2-1, and that's the agreement on that.
Three.
And also that we move forward and now to start a series of meetings. send our names through to the insurance to give them that?
Well, it would be two of us with the same one.
Okay, well, it would be two of us and myself, and the others as deputies as well. In the first instance, I think it would be Julie and a bit of a job share going on between Chris and Brian, but I'm sure Brian will be happy to help when she can. As long as we get some continuity, that's the main.
Moira, did you say it's going to be W2?
Well, that'll be for us to decide, but it's quite a hefty piece of work you're going to be asking us to do, isn't it? And I would like to get it finished before I leave the council in 3 or 4 years' time. I'm suggesting once for us, if that's too frequently for you, we can look at that. It's not set in stone.
In a way, would it be easier if they were a little bit less frequent?
Because
I think, if you leave an already committed to a lot of data, I work part time.
Well, should we perhaps say once a month and maybe what we can fit into our session?
That would be better.
Okay, thanks very much. You all agreed with that then? And then now I'm going to ask Vicky to talk us through item 6 on the agenda, which is going to be the main part of the work that we do over the coming year.
Yes, Section 37 of the Local Government Act of 2000 requires the council to have a constitution and to keep that constitution up to date. And obviously by undertaking regular reviews of the constitution and other key aspects of the council practices, that means that the risks to the council are mitigated. And while the council has from time to time over recent years undertaken reviews of various aspects of the constitution, introduction of new legislation and organisational restructure and the changing environment that we've been in over the last few years means that really a more significant and structured review of the council's constitution is now required. The purpose of that review is to ensure that all the necessary statutory requirements are reflected. Where choice is available to the council, then an informed view is taken about the options that are available, and to basically ensure that the constitution is fit for purpose. And alongside guidance that was produced to support the 2000 Act, the government issued a modular constitution which set out a suggested structure for a local government constitution. And an initial kind of overview of the constitution that we have at present has revealed some areas where our constitution varies from the modular constitution. And there are some documents which the modular constitution includes, which our constitution doesn't, and some documents which it's become regarded as good practice to include that perhaps are not there in ours. Doesn't mean necessarily that ours is wrong in any way, but obviously times change and things move on. So basically this report presents an approach to taking forward quite a major review of the council's constitution, which we envisage will take in the region of maybe 2 to 3 years. And so the committee is asked to agree and approve the progression of a review, and basically for the Constitutional Working Review Group to give consideration to a scoping document and set priorities and the timetable for carrying out that significant review of the constitution. Questions?
I'm a bit puzzled by some of this, because it's not about 3 or 4 years we've had a temporary solicitor. I can't remember the gentleman's title. I'm sure the officer was busy revising it all then, and we thought it was all wonderful then. I can appreciate the need to change names and job titles, and I probably still have somewhere at home some model constitution from when we were bringing in the new system in the year 2000 or whatever it is. So I'm just trying to get a feel about, is this tidy housekeeping, was it a major overhaul? Because I've just got this gut feeling we paid people a fortune to rewrite last time.
I think it's a major overhaul. I think there are certain things which are in the constitution but maybe are spread out in various different places. then we need to kind of bring them together, like the report talks about the executive procedure rules. We seem to have those rules kind of spread out. Obviously there has been quite significant change in terms of the structure of the council, so you know, the schemes of delegation, etc., will need to be reviewed. Some things like the planning code that we've just been talking about, you know, at the moment isn't there. So I think it will be quite a major piece of work. We're not just talking a few tweaks.
Well, Vicky, haven't we done much of this in the last 3 or 4 years?
We've tinkered, I think, is the
best. I think the last uploaded one on the website was October 17th.
Yeah.
We went to right.
Phil mentioned to us the other day when we met in the working room that he'd taken the opportunity before Christmas to take one of the parts that needed to be refreshed straight to full council because there wasn't time to bring it to the committee.
Absolutely.
And that was around budgets, and that was to make sure the budget was, you know, legally being set. But the other one that he really drew, I don't know if we just agreed the planning element, but the other one that he's keen for us to focus is the executive decision-making procedure. Having looked through this document, we're saying when we do the scoping document, we'll look at what work we're going to do, but also who we need to talk to in order to inform the decisions as well. So we may want to be talking to leaders of the political parties to get a view of that, and we'll do get a view of how they see the executive decision making process at the moment.
Yeah, I think what we've done over the last 12 months is that we've had a number of dealt with that.
Done this, yeah. Some of them have been very small changes.
Like,
yeah.
You know.
But at this stage, what we're looking for now is agreement that we proceed to look at the constitution, and the working group scopes that piece of work and then sets about undertaking.
My only comment to that was, instead of people here, is that we include the things we put in last year's working party as part of that, so we don't lose sight of some of the things we wanted to change within the existing constitution.
There was a smallish work programme that we had that we were going to set about, and I think you're right, we don't want to lose that while we're looking at the bigger piece of work. But are we okay to agree that?
Agree.
Have fun.
So exciting.
So jealous.
Right, anyway, can I say thanks very much, everybody, for your attendance?